everybody. Thank you so much for taking the time to be here today for this meeting. We welcome Mr. Cannon Briggs to us. Before we get started, I thought, and I'm Amy Galing, I'm the Chair of the County Commissioners. I think everybody knows most of us here. I thought maybe we would go around the table and introduce ourselves to Mr. Briggs so that he would know who we are. So, I guess Brian, if you
could
start.
Brian Nathan, Alamance County Manager.
Chris Hanson, Superintendent of Schools.
Steve Target, County Commissioner.
Andy Boswell, County Commissioner.
Steve Van Pelt, Board of Education.
Allison Mann, Board of Education.
Tony Rose, Board of Education.
Jeff Sutton, one of the County Commissioners.
Pam Thompson, one of the Board of Education members.
Bill Lashley, County Commissioner.
And we invited municipalities to come and participate. I see Lee Henry, Lee, if you would wait here.
Absolutely.
He's from
City of Graham.
City of Graham. And do we have any other county or town managers or city councilmen here? Okay, great. Thanks, Lee. All right, so now you know who we are, so I'll tell these folks a little bit about you. This is Mr. Cannon Briggs. He retired from the North Carolina Community College system in 2012 after 32 years in state and local government. He served for 4.5 years as executive vice president and chief of staff of the community college system, and for over a decade as vice president for finance and chief financial officer for the community college system. He began his career in local government as a county manager in two counties, Yadkin and Jones counties, but we won't hold that against you being a county manager. In the 6 years since retiring, Mr. Briggs has served as either interim president or interim chief financial officer at 5 community colleges in the system, and he has a robust consulting practice that includes board of trustee and senior leadership training and professional development, budget and policy analysis, operational and management assessments, and college bylaws and policy manual rewrites. So the things, I guess, that would put some of us to sleep are the things that keep going. Bylaws and policy manual rewrites. That sounds like a hard way to make a living. So welcome. He is here to tell us about different current options for construction methods for publicly financed projects. Some of the options help us understand the pros and the cons of the options and how to choose the right construction method for a capital project. How to ensure a cost-effective and timely construction where you end up with a high-quality end project. So welcome, and we are so grateful and thankful that you are here, Mr. Briggs.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I appreciate that very much so. So good morning, everybody. It is truly an honor to be asked before you today. Provide information about construction delivery models. Before I begin that conversation, I do want to congratulate you as an old county manager. It was a time when I was a young county manager. I had hair in those days. But I want to congratulate you and others around Alamance County for the recent enactment of the bond. I think a couple things about that general obligation bond for the benefit of the citizens of the county, from my experience in state and local government, it takes strong leadership to put such a measure on the ballot. It also takes strong leadership to get out and work for that and support it. And you provided that strong leadership. But it also takes strong leadership from the two educational leaders of the county, Alamance Community College and ADSS. So Mr. Superintendent, I will see Dr. Gaker in the room, but I work with him closely. Mr. Superintendent, I want to congratulate you as well. And the business community, I think from what I know, the business community worked very hard in support of this measure. It will pay dividends for many, many years for many people in the county, no doubt about it. I said I've done some significant work at Alamance Community College since about 2014. Joined Dr. Gakeley there before they began work on the Advanced Applied Technology Center. And I remember Dr. Gakeley meeting with every county commissioner at that time, having conversations about the importance of that facility, laying the groundwork, and then moving forward with the facilities plan. Those are things he and I did together. I think the investment you're making in Alamance Community College, which is recognized across the 58 college system, is a great institution. And what it does for adult learners and high school students are amazing to me. I'm going to walk you through today conversational, and I believe this has to be conversational to have value. Methods for delivery, some advantages and disadvantages, as Madam Chair said. I will tell you that there is no perfect method, but there are some methods that are tried and true better than others. And we'll explore some of those. And there's some opportunities. P3 is on your mind. We'll talk about that a little bit. I just entered into a contract with College of the Albemarle, the Derrick County campus, where I actually was last week, finishing up a presidential search for them, hiring a new president. I led that search. But they've asked me to work with them on the design of a new classroom building. They're taking two campuses in Derrick County, and they're both on Roanoke Island. One sort of in a near the water, which is not a good place, it's an older campus, and an old school. And they're merging those two into one brand new facility for Derrick County folks. In Derrick County, they have a number of early college high schools. They have one out on Hatteras Island. They have First Flight there in Kitty Hawk. And College of the Albemarle does a lot of good work with high school students. They want this building to be, if you will, high school and community college friendly. I'm going to help them design that building. Again, I will entertain questions along the way, and with that, we will kind of jump right in. I like to begin every presentation to any Board of Trustees, Community College Board, any public body, by reminding you of your fiduciary responsibility. I think that's important. And we're going to talk about that before we get into this, because in all that you do and consider, it needs to be true that you put the interest of the institution always, whether it's the Board of Education, the Board of County Commissioners, before any other interest. So we'll ask ourselves, what's a fiduciary, what responsibilities of a company being a county commissioner? You can insert the notion of school board to make that as well. So let me talk about that just a second as we jump into this, because I want you to be as open and objective about all that you hear today as possible. A fiduciary is a person who holds a personal responsibility to another person or an institution. In this case, the commissioners have a fiduciary responsibility to each other as the Board of Education members, you have a personal responsibility, whether it's to the County of Alamance. In the case of a governmental institution, those responsibilities range from financial to reputational, accountability to focusing upon whatever strategic plan or strategic priorities you've established. They can be seen as duties, and these duties are moral and legal in nature in all that you do. The most widely acknowledged responsibilities that you have either as a commissioner or Board of Education member are the duties of care, the duties of loyalty, and the duties of obedience. So let me talk about those very briefly. In another part of my life, notwithstanding writing policy manuals, which are boring but necessary, especially if you get in trouble, I don't know, like a zoning or land use plan, one might say, I chair the Board of Trustees at the University of North Carolina Asheville. I see my role as a trustee and as chairman of that board as a duty of care, and that means acting in good faith in all of my responsibilities, bringing all my professional skills and abilities to the table when considering anything put before me. But most importantly, serving the best interest of UNC Asheville. My notion for you is that duty of care is you're serving the best interest of the citizens of Alamance County and all that you do. In effect, it means showing up at meetings, well-prepared, attentive, if you will, ready to participate, knowledgeable on the matters coming before you. So that to me is an important responsibility for you, is a duty of care. Duty of loyalty, if you will. As a commissioner or a board member, it requires you to serve the interests of the institution and the public rather than your own self-interest, first and foremost. That's accompanied by the Ethics Act of North Carolina and the avoidance of conflicts of interest or the appearances of conflict. You should always put the interests of those who you're serving ahead of your own personal interests. In fact, for me at Asheville, it's costly to drive from Wilmington to Asheville 8 times a year and write scholarship checks. They don't pay me to do that. And so clearly I'm doing that for the interest of the institution and the students in that institution. And then finally, the duty of obedience, if you will. That's to ensure that the institution, whether it's the county government or the Board of Education and the school system, operate according to its purpose, the the statutes of North Carolina, and Wright has the right mission in place to serve. So those are important because you are ambassadors and guardians. You're ambassadors for the county, for the school board. You are guardians to protect the public's interest. And I wanted to get that on the table first, Madam Chairs, to say that in all we talk about today, that's important. There's some things to consider too on the front end before I dive deep into the topics of the day. I'll just throw these out there for consideration, your consideration. I think you may have to make in your roles facilities stewardship a core value. I think it has to be a core value because you deliver services through county facilities and you deliver education through public school buildings. So facilities should always be a core value of what you do. I think you have to link facilities and long-range planning with institutional priorities. As I've looked through and wondered, one of the best I've seen, Alamance County Facilities Plan, I see some things embedded in that that reflect his priorities. The mental health, the notion of a referral, if you will, providing for adequate court system spaces and those kinds of things. See, I think you're doing the right thing with the facilities plan, and this you should always do this as a governing body, in linking what you're trying to deliver, whether it's education or human services, with your facilities. They have to go together in the design and the administration thereof. Does that make sense to everybody? So it needs to be right in the midst of your strategic priorities and all that you do. I think it's also important that that you ensure leadership in that financial stewardship. As I understand it, you've had a technical committee meeting for some time, and you're about to have a sort of governor's committee to follow. That is excellent planning. Too many folks dive into facilities and don't have that governance piece in place. You're doing a great job of that from what I see by the committees you've already put in place. So I applaud you for doing that good work. Two other things, and I'll move on. Create some credibility for your investment decisions on the capital side. People have, now that they've given you the public trust with this $190 million and your own county capital plan, they need to hear and understand what it is you're doing. You're doing it in the public domain. And keeping that public trust ensures that you're making good, credible capital investment decisions. Does that make sense? And I think you're on the pathway. I applaud you for that. God knows I've seen places I haven't done it that well. And I think Alamance is ahead. And the last thing I'll say with respect to that is the accountability piece. I can't overstate the importance of the public domain now of being accountable, and I think you are. From what I've seen already with your plan, having this meeting today is evidence of the fact that you want to explore and go deeper. So I applaud you for it. So I set you up in that way, saying, if you will, you have a fiduciary responsibility, you've got the right plans, and now we're going to dive into the what part. So here's what we'll cover. The topics today. We're going to work through, if you will, some definitions of construction and contracting, the methods thereof, descriptions of those models, advantages and disadvantages. You need to hear what some of the advantages and disadvantages of that are. And then I'll use a case study and take Alamance's facilities plan and map that a little bit to some possible delivery models. It's just a real-life case study of what you want to do. And I had Mr. Superintendent spend quite a bit of time with your facilities plan and look at some of those things too. But I was asked to focus on the county. There probably is some carryover to the school system, if you will. That make sense to everybody? What we're going to do? Okay, good. Again, welcome questions. So let's talk about, more generally, the phase and design of construction. Let me give you some pieces of that. There are three basic phases. You define a project and the scope. The scope is what you, sort of the entirety of any individual capital project, what you're going to do. Some requirements, the time, and an estimate for cost. Once you define the scope pretty well, I've used the Alamance Community College AATC as an example. They knew kind of what they wanted to do and what they wanted to put in that building. Then that moved to the design phase, pretty standard. Once you've done the scope and the timeline and that sort of thing, you move to the design phase, and then you move ultimately to the construction. So three intentional steps in the way facilities are built. Now, having said that, there are five things I want you to think about in that process. In any given project, there are five things. Communications. Significant, thoughtful considerations given to all of these projects. Communications is key. Having a technical committee and having a governance committee is important. Those are continuous processes. Second, leadership group. We've already done that. Have a leadership group. Third, and this one's really, I call this one shared governance. It is input from stakeholders. Input from stakeholders. You want to have conversations with faculty, staff, trustees, community college folks, ABSS, county manager, commissioners. You can't have too much shared governance in this process. Because as an old county manager, as a community college system CFO, I have seen times when parties were isolated in their work and there was conflict. It is much better to be on the same page in a shared governance model as you go along the way. Because this is a multi-year endeavor. This is not a one and done, this is a multi-year process. Fourth is expertise. Expertise. What does that mean? Your designer or your architect is your friend. Be careful in that selection. We'll talk about selection process. Contractors and subcontractors and bidders are the people that actually do the work on the ground. That's important that you get the right firms to do that for you. We'll talk about it isn't just about low cost always, it might be value based. Discuss that. The construction managers and delivery models, we're going to talk about construction manager at risk. I had a conversation with a gentleman earlier this morning at ADSS. It's a great model. It protects the owner. Discuss that. And then the state construction office and or your county building. So, you know, in the community college world, community colleges used to be extremely ignored at the state construction office and how they slow down processes. But let me tell you, if something goes bad, and it can, just may as well be realistic. If it goes south with the construction of a project, with the contractor, they're the best friend in the world you have. Because they bring to bear the state of North Carolina, the Attorney General's office behind them, to say, you're going to get this right. We're going to get this right. We're going to take the project away from you. It's for bonding. But I'm saying, you want the state construction office. And then finally, is partnership. And that partnership is also critical. So those are the phases. They're well known and understood. Industry standard, scope and definition, design, construction. But I've given you some pointers to think about throughout this entire process. All right, a lot of stuff on this slide is pretty busy. Now I'm gonna give you up front delivery options, and then we're gonna work through each one of these individually. Everybody's familiar with design, bid, build. That's sort of the way that the industry goes about that. It's the oldest method in North Carolina. It's been around since the 1930s. It's otherwise known as the traditional method. We'll discuss single prime, multi-prime, and dual bidding. The CM at risk, construction manager at risk, has been around only since about 2001, so it's more recent. It's the case of owners screening for something other than a single prime or multi-prime, wanting some reputational votes at the table in the process. But those laws were amended in 2013-14 to give a little more flexibility to the owner. I'll tell you all about CM at risk, pluses and minuses. CM as agent is not a constructing contracting method, but we'll talk about what it actually is. So CM as agent is different in many ways, many ways, from the CMA. We'll go through that. And then the alternative methods, the 2013 session of the General Assembly enacted laws that were amended in 2014 that put on the table some alternative contracting methods, such as design build bridge, and 3P, as I'll call it, public-private partnership, I'll refer to as 3P. And I'll go through some of that because I understand it's interesting, Mr. Manager, in talking about some P3 opportunities. So we'll do that this week. So those are the deep dives we're going to do on every one of these, and we'll talk about pros and cons, advantages and disadvantages. Everybody with me so far? I'm covering a lot, but I'm trying to put a lot into this 2 hours. Again, either scream or throw something at me. I'm good either way. I've raised 3 daughters. They will tend to scream. My wife will tend after 38 years to throw something at me. So either way, let's go with design, build, bridge. Let's do it for me. Design, bid, build. Again, the traditional method, it's the project delivery method in which the owner contracts with separate entities for each of the design and construction of the project. It's your old identify and employ an architect, then think about the design. With the design comes the notion of how you're going to get it built, and with that comes construction. Here, it just lays out a very straightforward process. It can tend to take a little longer with this one, but truthfully, it's the tried and true method that's widely accepted across the state, if you will. Your designer selection is critically important. The community college system for formal projects, $500,000 or more, and I'm not sure how it is at county level per se, but you don't have a choice except to go through a designer selection, and that's a good thing. That keeps you from making critical mistakes along the way. You would consider in design selection such things as their previous experience designing public school buildings or working with the county, adequate experience support staff, have they ever been sued? If so, why? Quite frankly. How they handle change orders, if you will, because that's a nickel and dime game. It's because you spend a lot of money if it's not well defined up front. Are they local? How close local are they? Because you want them to come spend time with you. You're paying them to spend time and inspect your projects. But I would say to you, that piece is selecting that designer, you're going to live with them. It's really important that you get that part right. They can be your best friend. Again, design, bid, build is a traditional method. Let's talk about it. It's well-defined in statute. If you want to look at it yourself, go to the statute, spend a little time, it's online. GS 143-128, it's called public contracts. I'm sure everybody's familiar that does this work with that. There are 4 pieces to any design, bid, build. HVAC, systems, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, plumbing and gas fittings, electrical wiring, we all know that, and then the general work, the general construction. Those 4 pieces are in any project, no matter what project you're doing. You're going to have those 4 pieces. But the methods by which those services can be delivered can come in one of 2 forms. They are in the form of separate prime contracts. They're called multi-prime or single-prime contracts, if you will. The separate prime is a case where each of those 4 components would be bid separately, and we'll talk about the advantages and disadvantages, but meaning the owner has to look at all 4 pieces all the time. Not a great method of delivery. Used to be the standard until the laws changed to create single-prime. Single-prime means a general contractor will take care of all of the security of those bids, those pieces for you, and roll it into one quote, one bid. You can bid them both ways at the outset, but that can be also a little challenging. And there are laws governing how someone who bids multi-prime can bid single-prime. They can't bid 2 different prices, if you will. That's a little complicated. But it is truthfully a method. Let me back up a second. Let me give you the advantages and the disadvantages of this approach. The advantages of design, bid, build in a delivery model versus, say, CM at risk or design build. Let me just go through these briefly. Some of the advantages of the design, bid, build. The design team is impartial, meaning your architect is impartial as to who does the work. And it should be that. They look out for the interest of the owner to a great extent in the process. The design team prepares documents on which all contractors compete and bid. And it's a standard, this is what you're bidding on, electrical, HVAC, plumbing. This is what, or the construction is. This is what you're bidding on. It ensures fairness and openness. And the bids are open in a public setting. So anyone can attend those bids. The citizens of Alamance County can attend those bids. It's a very iterative and open process. And generally works in the best that. Now, you saw from this chart, that takes time. That takes time for that process to work. Design time on a facility can be from 12 to 18 months to get all the details in the right order in the right place. If that happens, the slowest method, because all that design work has to be approved before you can move forward. There's always a tendency to seek out the lowest cost subcontractors. You know, the profitability of the general contractor is how cheaply can they get each of those pieces of work done. And it affects their bid. And I think lowest cost, my friends, isn't always the best delivery. It's what my dad used to say, you get what you pay for. Sometimes it's not the best delivery. As the general contractor, though, is brought in after the design is completed, then they may see things that are going to be change orders or cost adjustments after the fact. So they're not in early in the design. Are you following what I'm saying there? If you get the design, if you get the contract to the table a little earlier sometimes, you can get better input on the design and cost you less money in the end game. And that doesn't happen with this model. As you can see, the design work is done, the project goes to bid, and you're selecting a contractor rather than the overplay between the design and the contractor's voice. And then there, I'm going to be candid, if the architect is the owner's rep, there can be disputes between the architect and the contractor. Mr. Boswell's nodding at me. But there can be times when it ain't a pretty place to put, because there can be conflict between the two. Because the architect's protecting your interest, the contractor's preserving their bottom line. Preferences, I had a conversation with the engineer at UNC Asheville, my trust dealer. We just talked through building some dorms. We're renovating a major building. We're going to build a building. I would say to you in terms of single prime versus multi-prime or separate prime, in his words, you sort of avoid multi-prime like the plague, and who wants the plague? Because nobody has ownership. You've got individual contractors running around doing their thing. Job sites can be a mess. No one's so in charge of the project. And so I would say, there's on that one. I think you might not consider multi-prime and focus more on the single-prime method, especially for smaller projects. On larger projects, you can run into bid busts. We'll talk about what that means in a minute. You can negotiate on small projects and you get the best value. So your first big piece and your big chunk is the more widely known design, bid, build. Those are the phases, and I would caution you away from multi-prime toward the single-prime delivery method. Does that make sense for everyone? Questions? Okay. Let me pause, and I may come back to this, but let me pause and say there are three things at play here. There is the county capital plan for county facilities. There's the ADSS plan for capital facilities. And there's the Alamance Community College plan for capital facilities. Now, what I have advised Alamance to do since I've done work there for 5 years or so is to consider, even though they'll be hiring architects, is to consider their own construction management, their own owner's rep process. I've told Dr. Gatewood and his team that I believe from what I've seen, where UNC Asheville has, for example, an on-staff person who can inspect projects along the way, have conversations with contractors and architects. They go to market just like this. We go to market for design, bid, build, CM/BIS, and whatever. There's still one person that works for the owner that can report to the owner about the progress of projects and those kinds of things. And I know there's some interest and conversation here about whether or not Alamance County does that. I think ABSS, Mr. Superintendent, has designated an individual, I think Mr. Russell, to be your project manager. And I think that's important for the schools to have that advised Alamance. I think the question becomes, where does the county go? What does the county do about its owner's rep? Because the county's the banker. I learned from C.D. Spangler a long time ago, who was president of UNC System, in presentations of the North Carolina General Assembly. Mr. President Spangler stood before the members of the House and Senate Appropriations Committee and said, you are my bankers. My job is to be on the same page with my bankers, if you will. And so I think the notion becomes whether Alamance County considers its own owner's rep, construction manager, to work cooperatively with ABSS and ACC, their owner's reps, so that we stay on the same page in this process. Does that make sense? It's something to think about. I just know that we do it at Asheville, and our engineer there, David Todd, is phenomenal. And he interacts on a daily basis with the contractors, the architects, the engineers on site, and to advise us boards of trustees every time we meet. We hear from them. Okay. He tells us where we are in status, what the challenges are, cost overruns, project management issues, and that sort of thing. I put that out there as something to consider. So, Madam Chair, I just think that's important to put on the table. Everybody still with me?
Just looks like the ultimate accountability partnership.
Absolutely. I get back to my original things to pay attention to, the principles of facility construction, especially in a big scope like this. It does. It means you've got the professionals talking to professionals, and then your professional talking to you, whether you're a school system, community college, or county commissioners. Yes, sir.
Now, if I'm hearing you correctly, you don't recommend that one individual report all three, you're thinking. That's three of our jobs.
It's a great question. I'm a believer in shared governance, and I'll tell you at a university campus, there's the faculty, there's the Board of Trustees, and there's the Chancellor. And we all have to be on the same page to make progress in the institution. And I think, given that you've got $150 million in play in the school system, they need a construction manager, a project manager, because someone's got to coordinate all of this work. And it's a full-time job. It really is. I've advised Alamance with $39 million of county bond money in play, and they have $7 million of state NC Connect bonds in play. This is the same conversation we had with the board. I think the county also, because it's kind of, it's the banker, it's the umbrella, it's the fiduciary role that we went over at the very beginning of this conversation, might consider, county manager, Madam Chair, members of the board, your own person who interplays as that sort of closes the triangle of shared governance. Does that make sense? And it's something to consider. This is a big deal. Largest bond in the county's history. It's a big deal. It's a good deal. It's just a big deal. So, I throw that out. Okay. I'll move along. Good question, sir. Thank you. CM at risk. This one is, again, been around since 2013-14. It's an excellent delivery. You can see the timeline there. Let me talk to you about it just a little bit. CM at risk. Means you're engaging a service, a construction management service, between the architect and the general contractor. And in that process of engagement, you're looking to the CM, who will ultimately be responsible for delivering your project at a guaranteed maximum price. You really do all the work on the front end, so there's no surprise with bid opening day on the back end. All right? right? The CM you pay, who doesn't do the actual construction of any of the four pieces, not the general construction, not the electrical, not the plumbing, and the HVAC, but they're the firm or individual, and I recommend a firm, it spreads the risk around just a little bit within. They're the ones that work with the designer. As you can see here, pre-construction services, you select your CM early and your designer so that all that detailed design work includes the person who's going to oversee the actual construction of the project, who's going to hold people accountable, all your subcontractors accountable. And they give you a price on the front end. The more conversation they have on the front end during the design phase, the better off the owner is in terms of total project cost. Is everybody with me today? We use CM at Risk on the Advanced Applied Technology Center at ACC. We've used it a number of times at UNCA. There's a place at which it becomes probably not wise to hire them because there is a cost of doing that. There is a cost of employing the CM at Risk. So it's not the cheapest delivery method, but it may be the most comprehensive or protective investment for the owner. That would be a school system, community college, or the county, if you will. Again, that's a growing industry standard being used in the UNC system, the public school system, and certainly the community, university system over time. Let me give you the advantages and sort of disadvantages, if you will, that. Then I'm going to back up. Some of the advantages of CM at Risk. It does speed up the project. You're not waiting until the design is completed to then go through the rest of the process. You have that upfront design engineering work done. So when you go to market, the CM can get that guaranteed maximum price for you. You know what you're paying for upfront. It's valuable in that design phase. And I will tell you that the CM at Risks that do business in North Carolina, I have worked with a couple. One I'll just name for the purposes here of conversation that worked at ACC. They know the best contractors in the market. They go out and they approve them. I mean, in essence, they say, this is what the project looks like. You had experience in this area. So they invite those people to bid, if you will. It's transparent. Your fees are right up front in a contract, if you will, and it's all out in the open. It's all everyone can see. If the bid packages come in higher than expected, it's on that CM to get those costs down within that guaranteed maximum price. So they have some skin in the game. They really have a lot of skin in the game to make sure that the scope of work fits within the price guarantee. It's on them, so to speak.
Let me ask you a question.
Sure.
Would you recommend hiring an individual or a company to be your CM?
I think a company's better, and I'm talking about on any individual capital project. I'm distinguishing that from an owner's rep at the county level, for example. Okay. Yes, sir. I'm segregating the two. I think the delivery model CM at Risk would be a firm, a company. And there are a lot out there who actually, again, they're not allowed to do the actual construction, if you will. There are a lot of firms out there that have done the construction that understand it, that make great CMs. So they've had experience actually building these things, these projects, and so they make for great CMs.
I think one of the things with that is you have a larger firm that has staff to handle HVAC, plumbing, that understand
it, right.
And they can go out and find the people.
That's exactly right. Thank you.
I was going to ask, like in 2004, what prompted this position to be created? Hot mess after hot mess.
Correct. Yeah, that's exactly right.
Good answer.
That is exactly right.
Somebody's got to be burned for something like this to happen.
They were, the owners were screaming in the marketplace that they were having difficulty with multi-prime, and they were not getting the representation they thought they should on single-prime. And they said, we want someone that has skin in the game, like the guaranteed maximum price, has skin in the game and will bring this project in where it's supposed to be and avoid the cost overruns and the bid busts and those kind of things. And Gerald Stanley said, makes sense to us, and thus the law. And the changes that 2004 and the changes in 2013. That's exactly right. Great point.
So is there an incentive there to bring it in under the projected cost?
If it happens, that's money in the pocket of the CM. There's their price. Not only do they make profit, they make profit on profit if they get that work done.
Do they not share some of that profit?
I'm sorry?
Do they not share some of that profit?
I think that's got to be in the contract right up front. I think if the contract doesn't speak to it, that money's going in their pocket. If you write the contract in such a way that they do share savings, absolutely. I think that's key to get that contract right up front. I can pause and take a time out too. Sort of, since I'm covering CM at risk and I've covered the design bid build, the state construction office, generally, you can recommend to them who you want as an architect, and they will listen to you if you establish that relationship with someone like the local government commission. Make the state construction office your friends. They too can help with that. And they negotiate that fee, that rate, with the architects on design projects and on CM projects. So you want to have that friendly relationship with the state construction office as you go about building all these buildings, if you will. And they can help you with your contracts. They've seen them all. They can help you with your contracts.
Yeah. And these firms, they have to go to the state construction with these projects too. And they have to know how to navigate that. I'm a general contractor, but I would have no clue how to navigate that carrying it to the state because I don't do that kind of work.
They have the relationships.
Yes.
Those tribes have relationships. Again, I'm back to the point that if something goes south with a project, you want state construction to say that if you want to do business in North Carolina, you'll get this one right. They bring the power of the state to bear for your benefit. They're a governmental entity just like you are. Is this helpful? Is this helpful, by the way?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Okay. I feel like I'm racing, so take a deep breath. Make sure I'm in the right spot.
While you take your notes, I'll let everybody else know a couple things. I'm not sure if I mentioned in your, when I was going over your bio, that you've been the chairman of the Board of Trustees for UNC Asheville.
Yes, ma'am.
I think I skipped over that and have served in some different roles at that university, which is amazing. And also tell everybody that Mr. Briggs lives in Wilmington, and he is anxious to make sure that he gets on I-40 before they reverse the lanes and gets home to help his wife board up the windows. So he is racing and a little distracted, and we certainly have grace for that situation. So I appreciate you not canceling.
Absolutely. And again, I want this to go as slow as it needs to go so that everybody's questions are answered. So don't let my... I did a lot of work getting things ready yesterday. My wife practices oncology at New Hanover Regional Medical Center. And I think they're shutting the cancer clinics tomorrow down because we're going to get some serious weather. But I do want this to go as slow as it needs to be. And I told her I would be home in time to finish the final preparation. So after 38 years of marriage, she said, you better, my friend.
I doubt Dorian has anything on her.
That's right. Just, again, these are I would call them just facts about this. And by the way, at the end of the presentation, we do have a hard copy of this. I just wanted your attention as we walk through so that we could have a conversation. Again, I learned in the legislature many years ago that if I gave this to the members while I was trying to present, they didn't hear me. They weren't reading. So I think better we talk and then you'll have a hard copy. And I'm even going to leave you a little 6 or 7 page primer that has the delivery methods laid out and explained what the state statute. I felt like that was a little bit. This is a lot of stuff. So I thought you would. Okay. Needless to say, I'm a little bit of an advocate for CM at risk, especially on larger projects. I think it's a good method. And I think you've made that decision, Mr. Superintendent, for your new high school. Is that right? think that's a good delivery model. I truly believe that I think it's worked at ACC very well.
I've already done that.
Yes, sir. I think it's that. Absolutely. I think it's a very good delivery model, quite frankly. Again, hear me say, it's not the cheapest method, but it may be the best value method throughout the process. Okay. CM is agent. This is another one of those delivery methods I talked about earlier. The CM and agent, CM is agent model, let me tell you, it's not a construction model. The agent works with the college, it works with, it's like a designer. In effect, it's a person who prepares the trade packages, solicits bids, and does some of the scheduling. But I will tell you that it's really just multi-prime. It's one person serving as an agent doing multi-prime, but doesn't have any skin in the game like a CM. A CM is giving you a maximum price and is there trying to make sure that stays in place and that all the subcontractors get their work delivered. But they don't have really any skin in it. They're just like an overseer without a tremendous amount of authority. It is a delivery model. It has been used. And it is a competitive basis. But you as the owner own the contracts. Then you're back to having fights with the subcontractor. I hate to say it that way, but you're back to being responsible as owner for the successful completion of the contract. Why would you want that responsibility? I can't imagine. Why do you want that responsibility? So, again, they do this work for you. And it is a competitive value-based selection, but it looks very much like a multi-prime delivery. And I'm just not sure you want that responsibility. Okay, there are some alternative contracting methods. There are three. So the traditional one, just a little refresher, in the design bid build, there is single prime, there's multi-prime, there's CM at risk, and there's CM as agent. We'll talk about, when we narrow the scope a little bit, you're getting the whole big picture, but when we narrow the scope just a little bit, we'll talk about advantages of single prime, CM, and these alternative contracting methods. There are really three the law provides for. Design build bridge, and public-private partnerships. Can you see this? Okay. So let's talk about the first of those, design build. Okay. It's a delivery method in which the design and construction services are contracted by a single entity, which is the design build contractor. It relies on a single point of responsibility. You're choosing one firm to do the design and the build. You're handing that responsibility over. And it minimizes risk for you, in some senses of the word, and it can shorten the delivery schedule. As you can see from the chart, you know, you select your design build team, your firm, and then that design and pre-construction, it all kind of rolls together. You have one point of contact. So you're not dealing with an architect or a CM or a contractor. You're really dealing with one point of order. So let me talk a little bit about sort of how that will work in statute. Because there are some statutory arrangements, alignments around that. If you can really well define your project, you truly get scope laid out. The statute says you must do that prior to issuing a request for qualifications, an RFQ. If you have time constraints in getting something done, you need to do it relatively quickly. You have to define that. You have to ensure as owner at the end of the game you're going to have a quality project delivered, the statute says. you're also going to have to oversee and manage that yourself, because you're putting all of that responsibility on one firm, one company. And you're going to have some professional on staff. You have to demonstrate, and I'm quoting the statute here, the capability of the governmental entity to manage and oversee the project, including the availability of experienced staff or outside consultants who are experienced with the design, build, method of delivery. So in essence, you've got to have a team, an individual or a team at the county level that can manage that project. I'm just not sure you want that responsibility, and that it's not going to be cheap. And why not use the C and the PIST model if you're going to do that, for goodness sake?
Well, do we know what program the Elon University used to build the new Elon Elementary?
I guarantee you it's this one.
It would fit more so in like a design build. It would fit more probably a design build model because it was a private paid.
Right.
It's a private university doing a private work. They used Pinnacle Architects and Sound Construction. It was the architect on record and the construction company, which they had a relationship with previous schools before. So to me, it would fit more probably in the design build.
And it's basically the same school that
it was a school that's been built. It was a school that's been built several times in the school.
So let's talk about that again. In the public sector, in the public sector, you may have to meet so many more qualifications than in the private sector for design. They're scripted in statute. There's a hesitancy on the part of the state construction office. You would have to get their approval to do a design build as a public entity. Private sector doesn't have to do that. They own. Now, there are some, so they can move more nimbly. They have relationships. I think that's a very important point. You know, I had a relationship with a contractor or a firm to build. They need to be simpler projects rather than more complicated projects. I've got some ideas for you about, look at Alamance County's projects, and I've recommended some things to the Alamance community on some design deals, so I don't think I'm suggesting that I'm not in favor of that in some instances. I think it can work. But I think in the public sector, you have to jump through so many more hoops in the statute. I'm looking at 140, and I'll give you this one, you might want to write 143, 128A. So you might want to take a look at the statute about. There's another piece of this that I haven't hit. I'll hit it now. In all public contracts, the general statutes require all public entities, that would be city, county, town, schools, community colleges, and universities, to make a good faith effort to bring minority subcontractors to the table. And in fact, your CM at risk has a responsibility that you contract with them to hold some public fora and invite minority contractors to participate. The reason that's a good practice is because, for example, all taxpayers of Alamance County are paying for the amortization of the bonds. So all contractors, minority or otherwise, women-owned, ethnically and gender diverse, should have some skin in this game because they're all paying for the rate for the bonds.
Well, it keeps some money in Alamance County.
Absolutely.
Too.
There's no doubt about it. Absolutely. I think any contract you have, you ought to absolutely pound into your CM or your single prime contractor, the responsibility to use local contractors wherever possible in this county, because they're paying the tab, so to speak, in taxes. I think it's an absolute must. So in the design build domain, you are responsible for making sure that design builder, again, the statute requires a good faith effort to comply with having small businesses and minority-owned businesses and women-owned businesses participate in the process.
I think one of the main reasons I like this program the best is what Dr. Thorpe told me when he said that Elon University built it for $18 million. If we'd done it, it would cost around $23 million. Isn't that right, Tom?
That's what this is.
Yeah, so we got essentially $5 million saved in one project, and this was a whole lot cheaper than the high school.
And can you tell us where that $5 million, what that does? Like, if you can build it for this, why do you need to have $5 million extra to build the same school? Who gets that $5 million?
Not being able to look at the contract, I couldn't tell you.
I mean, why does it cost $5 million more for those people?
All the requirements that you have to do.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right, Mr. Blackstone. Governmental contracting is absolutely more expensive because, for example, if you're building, I'll just pick them. If you're a community college building an early college high school on your campus, which more and more community colleges do, we have 124 early college high schools in North Carolina, then, for example, you're going to have to meet some code, life safety code requirements, for elementary, middle, high school students that you may not have to meet anywhere else in the domain of North Carolina. The state school construction manual is going to make you do certain things. If you're building a community college building, you're going to have to meet some very specific code requirements of state construction, the state building code, and the state fire marshal. It's just the way that it is at the public entity. And those safety requirements cost more money. That's my experience. Is that fair? I think that's where, and that money's going in the contractor's pocket.
And could part of it be the pre-construction cost?
Absolutely.
Adding up where they had a designed building already, and having to pay that architect on the fee to design a building. They had that. And they had a company that had already built that project. Am I right? So it's easier for me to go build two houses the same because the second one, I know what it costs. Right, Jim?
And I think those requirements, we can call them onerous. It's slower. You're going to get inspections. You can't move to the next place without an inspection. But they're designed to protect the public interest. And they're cumbersome and they're expensive, but there is the public protection portion that goes along with that. And so it costs, I will never stand here and tell you, it doesn't cost more to build a public building than a private building. It does.
Like useful life, isn't it supposed to be built to a longer useful life as well?
The statutes now talk about, absolutely, the statutes now are written in such a way, sustainability is a big issue, and materials are going to last longer. There's some level of requirement of using recycled materials. It's just, yes, it costs more to build public buildings than it does private buildings. Yes, ma'am, I'm sorry, I gave you a long answer, but my experience is you will never build a building in public domain, county, city, town, public schools, community colleges, universities, cheaper than you'll build it in private. You just won't.
Even though it's the same brick or the same cinder block, it's still going to, I don't like this. It's different. I don't understand. I don't like it. But whatever.
Pam, one of the things he mentioned right up front, to do design build, the owner has to have the scope of work in mind. And having that scope in mind, you really cut out a lot of the process and find somebody to come up with all that.
That's what I was really important for.
All right. Well,
I think also we certainly have a progression we did too. We know what, we don't know exactly, we know around about what the building costs, but we don't know what the private sector is paid to have any of the initial testing, any of the initial groundwork. We don't know what any of that was.
Right. There's the soil, engineering.
Or the quotes that we received, absolutely. You know, was a package deal. So, you know, that $5 million may get shrunk down real quick when you start putting in that engineering and all that other stuff, because we don't know what that upfront cost was.
Yeah,
as compared to what it would be in public.
That's right, Ms. Thompson, that's what I said. If I were looking at two contracts, a design build private sector, a single prime or CM at risk public contract. In the public contract, you've got to spell out all of your costs, and they're going to include things that you just mentioned. You've got to have soils tests done for rock in case you're going to hit rock when you're putting down the foundation. You've got to have specialty engineering services and inspections along the way that you're going to have to bring an outside contractor specialist in to look at those. I think Mr. Boswell knows that. Again, your public requirements are greater at they, I don't know how to say it in the way, I'm being redundant, but they're going to cost more along the way than what the private can do it for. If you watched, I think the perfect model to watch right now is the State Employees Credit Union. They are replicating the same model all across the state of North Carolina. They've got it down to a science. They got a company they work with. They've got design specs already, and all they're doing is replicating that area. Now, that said, I think the Office of School Construction and Department of DPI, or what's left of DPI, has templates for schools to build, and that can be helpful because contractors will know what they're bidding on. They can look at others. But again, I guess the point is every community is a little bit different in what they need to build, want to build. Some have big athletic programs, some don't. Some have specialty programs within their schools that can offer science and things that require labs. Labs are more expensive than our general classroom buildings. In community college, we build a lot of labs. We build a lot of skills labs, which are very expensive. We talk about a welding lab. We talk about a machining lab. They're very expensive. So you've got your electrical drops are more. Cooling and air systems are greater. It just depends on what you're building. It can run into some very expensive activities. But this is a big conversation. This is the kind of conversation, Madam Chair, you're supposed to be having. You're supposed to be throwing this on the table and thinking about how you can afford it.
I just have one more question.
Please.
So there's a room at DPI that has plans to schools. Okay. If we take a field trip and go to look at high school in Mayberry, and it's just what we want, and they don't have that plan in that room as a public school system, why can't we borrow that plan?
I'm not sure I can answer that question.
Who do I need to ask that question?
They let you borrow the plan. They may sell you the plan. They want you to borrow.
What?
She said if they didn't have the plan, more you know, could you borrow it?
I think you meant if they had the plan there.
Yeah.
Oh, if they had it.
Why can't we just build a school like that?
Well,
it'd be a lot cheaper.
Yeah.
A lot cheaper.
So let's hit the. No, you shouldn't be sorry.
It's really frustrating to see how we get ripped off. That's the word I'm going to use. Go ahead, sorry.
That's it. Please don't apologize to me. What is the old saying? I don't make the news, I just deliver the news. So, let's go advantage or disadvantage. I'll hit the high points on design build and we'll move on. There's a single point of responsibility, and a lot of that falls to the owner. There's a firm price early on. You kind of know, as you're moving to that design phase, before you get to construction, you kind of know what the price is going to be. You can do value engineering. If you exceed your budget availability, you can begin to take things out and downsize the project a little bit. And then time. It clearly, because you've got some overlap right here in this overlap, you can pick up some time, shortens the time of construction. If you remember the earlier charts, it was more drawn out on traditional methods. Now the disadvantages, the contractor is deciding design issues as well as related to cost and profits and time. The design build, they're going to make their profit. I'm just going to tell you, they're not in the business of losing money. Again, if it's a complex project, if it's complex and elaborated for aesthetical purposes or technical purposes, I already mentioned shops and labs, or if it's certain qualities unique to a public school, this is not your best way to go. It's just not. You probably need that personal care and touch of an architect. Design build doesn't make use of competitive bidding. So you're not getting competition, you're getting one price. And then the criteria to select the contractor is subjective. In any designer selection, you need well-defined criteria and selections. Okay. Speaking point. Can you advance from there? Did you do it or did I do it?
I'm not sure.
I think I did.
It was you.
Look at the. I'll be done. All right. design, build, bridge. This is even more far-fetched. The design, build, bridge is a very interesting animal where you are paying someone to contract for design criteria services separate and apart from the construction piece, and that design, that designer has to be a design professional identified under statute, if you will. They design 35% of the design work and 100% of the construction work, and they hand that off to another entity to provide for the completion of the design package, or for the construction package. Again, the governmental entity has to make sure that it knows the site, the scope, the budget that anticipated. And then that 35% design package is put together by the design professional, if you will. And then again, it's sort of handed off to the next phase. I don't know why this one makes sense. It's never made sense to me. But again, before you contract for design services, you've got to designate a professional, a design criteria professional, to begin that all that work on the design criteria package. And 35% of that work's done to lead to the documentation portion for construction. It is as convoluted as anything I've ever seen in the law. Somebody's using it because it's made progress, but I've tried every which way. I don't know anybody using this.
If you bring in two designers, would it be more expensive too?
It typically is more expensive. And even the process by which you select the design build professional is very common. So I'm just wanting to know it's out there and I'm going to move on. I don't know why anybody uses this. I just don't.
Could it be that the site has some kind of really complex thing with it? I'm thinking like maybe you have a designer who can sort of get things started, but there's something strange about the location of the project where you really need somebody who's very technically like on the side of a mountain or something like that?
It could be. I just don't know or have any experience in this delivery. I don't know if anybody else does, but I don't know why you necessarily do it. All right. 3P. So here in the North Carolina General Statutes, in any public-private partnership, the private developer has to have at least 50% of the financing cost available to deliver. Okay? So if they're going to have 50% of the project cost that they contribute to, that means they've got to get something in return. They've got to recover their 50%, and you know they're in business to make a profit, so they got to recover cost, of course. So I'm going to give you some of the traditional things around 3P. I'm not opposed to it. I just had a long conversation with a trustee at a community college on the drive up here yesterday about P3 and their thinking. You can see construction of a facility or improvements, paving, grading, or infrastructure, construction, or repair. It's all in the statute as permissible activity. But again, it gets a little more complicated from there. So let's talk about traditional, and then we'll talk about some of what's going on in the marketplace. So you could have the developer, you could enter into an arrangement where the developer is technically getting the architectural work done, construction contract documents all ready to go, you sign an arrangement with them, a contract that you want real tight, really carefully worded, and then you're going to build something. Traditional P3 partnerships in the public domain have been around dining facilities, typically at a university or community college. I don't know of them in K-12, they may exist. But around dining facilities, and there it's cafeteria style, it might be a cafe, it might be them coming in to occupy space and being willing to build that out, build the space out they're going to use. Another traditional partnership is around student centers or bookstores. They will build student centers, they will build bookstores. Increasingly, in higher ed, that's happening, tech cafes or industry equipment rooms and furnishings. The big one is residence halls for residential places. Literally, that's not K-12, it's not the county, it's not community colleges. But making housing affordable to students, going in and building those things out, if you will. Recreational facilities or intramural facilities. Sports is another big partnership. Business incubators, where you are trying to create an innovative space for small businesses getting off the ground, if you will. The way those things are typically done, I'll use A&T State since they're close by. A&T State needed some facilities built. They had a campus that was in need of renovation. And typically it's a ground lease. NC State has done this for their Centennial campus. It's a ground lease for the footprint. And the private developer or contractor signs an agreement with the owner of the land, and they build something. They build a dorm, they build a dining hall, they build a student center, they build some kind of public space for students. And the college or the entity, governmental entity, provides a long-term lease. So the developer recoups their investment, their part of the investment and the profit portion by the rents charged, the fees paid, the usage of the facility, and that money amortizes the debt. The ground lease is sufficient to allow the developer to recoup all of that and make profit. And at some point, under some contracts, the property then reverts back to the owner. That's the typical public-private partnership. I've stretched my knowledge and thoughts, because I was alerted to this one up front. I'm having a difficult time thinking through how someone would make money sufficient to do P3 on a high school campus, public school campus, or community college campus. More a community college, and certainly a university, because in the university's case at NC State Centennial, they had private companies coming in and doing research, or product development, or even some level of manufacturing, where students were involved in that research and learning lab, and the entity engaged that and paid NC State a royalty. But I'm struggling to think how a developer would want to jump into this in a pre-3 partnership, unless it was more of a design-build arrangement. I'll give you an example. A parking deck makes a lot of sense. A parking deck on a design-build arrangement where a developer builds a park, designs and builds a parking deck. The fees generated from that amortize the investment made by the contractor or developer, and then at some point, once that cost plus profit is recovered, then the governmental entity would get the profits off of it. Once that debt's satisfied and once that profit is made, it's either shared. Or I think Central Piedmont and Charlotte Community College built with a P3 on parking debt, and that was fee driven. So the debt was amortized to the private developer for the cost of that, and the college recovered its cost. So I'm really struggling, and I'd love to hear dialogue about what's being thought about in P3, because most of the P3s I'm familiar with have to do with post-secondary. housing. Or the new model is building residential spaces and having business spaces co-located. So I'd like to hear what's being thought about peak learning in the context of either a public school or a community college or a campus.
I did have a conversation with some of the folks over at Salmon.
Yes.
And they said they would do a high school under free.
Say that again, Steve.
I said I had a conversation with the guys at Salmon, and they said they had investors that would work with them to do a high school under triple B.
And I'm just thinking out loud. So this is.
I am too. And what you just said, that doesn't sound like it makes sense.
Yeah. So in a P3, with a in a P3 there, investors would do it, but the governmental entity is going to still have to amortize the debt.
Right.
There's no revenue generating possibility for a high school. So I guess the question for me, and I'm just thinking like a CFO, I can't help myself. I've tried to unlearn some of that, but it won't ever leave me. The notion of that is it, and I've seen this bump up against some housing projects, is it cheaper for the government to access money through its bond rating, meaning the cost of money is lower to the governmental entity than it would be to pay a profit margin to a private investor for an ROI? Mm-hmm. You're a banker. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
If I can leverage governmental money through a governmental bond with a great bond rating and get that cost of money at 5% or 6%, 4% maybe, versus a private investor who's going to want 6% to 7% to 8% return on that money, I'm struggling with that. Is that?
Could it be though because of their initial investment?
Right.
For sure.
Project is going to be less than what the government is. Yes, I know the interest is a big deal, but they can come in $5 million under. That's a head start on that.
Well, they've already got a plan. Yes.
But don't we lease it?
They do.
Like lease and pay. And
then that's exactly what it is.
It's like you drive that car, and then when it's up, you
that's why I love it. They told me about it.
That's a great idea.
But do we ever own it? Do you ever
own it? Well, you do eventually own it.
Under state law, because I wrote some of this language in community colleges, under state law, I got tired of community colleges leasing buildings and never having any value. In other words, you're taking state funds, leasing a building for community college to occupy, but never having any ownership.
So this isn't like rent to own.
Well, that's exactly what I had to state treasurer we wrote into our statute 115B, rent to own, lease to own, because I'm thinking, if you're spending state money and you never own it, where's the value to the state? So I wrote statutory language. The treasurer agreed with it. We got enacted in the law and said, okay, we'll have a lease arrangement at the end of the 10-year lease. I own the property as a governmental entity. You follow what I'm saying? So in this sense, if I'm taking public taxpayer dollars, I'm going to want to own something at the end of the lease time. So you, in essence, you hold the ground, you own the property, you do a long-term lease in which you're paying them back for their investment.
Right.
At the end of the term, you own the real estate.
Right. You did a ground lease for X amount of
ground
years.
Lease is what I absolutely
and that's like, quote-unquote, errands. You got people that want to rent to own the VCR by the time they own it, they paid $2,500
for it.
I don't want to pay $112 million for a high school.
And it's appreciated.
Yeah.
I guess that's my point. You see what I'm saying? I'm struggling a little. What about the cost of money? Two, you would definitely want to own the residual.
Well, another factor too is they do the maintenance and repair and upkeep on it. So
you do.
That means you're not hiring
the maintenance
crew for that particular piece of property. And when you get it back, it's up to date. It's been refurbished. Okay.
Sure. Again, for an enterprise operation where there's revenue, recurring revenues, it absolutely makes sense. I flew to Dallas to meet the Dallas Community College District 2 weeks ago. In the state of Texas, the governmental entities are there, and Dallas is treated as one of the Dallas Community College District. It makes a lot of sense for them to leverage because they have tax reform and they can generate revenue. It's a different model here than the LEA only has that which the county government appropriates. And then the fees they generate from cafeteria, parking, athletics, or whatever.
you aware of the $1.3 million program they did down in Greenville, South Carolina? I know, I think, Tim, you said you did some research on that?
Yeah, they have their own tax authority.
That's the key.
And they have also have debt limits.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
If you have taxing authority, which neither K-12 or community colleges have, and you can't incur debt per se, that would be different, because you have a revenue stream that can amortize that debt in the partnership. As a government entity, I'm just not, I can't get them as a former county manager.
Mr. Briggs, that $5 million I was asking you about a while ago, are these private people gonna have to pay that $5 million, or are they gonna get that deal?
So that's a good question. What I can speak to the community college statutory language, even if it's a partnership, they have to build to the state spec, to the state construction office standard. You can't build to a standard or code outside of the state code, even if you're a private developer. Does that make sense? I'm saying to you, because you hire a private to build it for you, if you're a public governmental, if you're a governmental entity, they got to build a state code. They have no choice. If you're building a public school, it's got to be built to the state safety code for public school children. Remember my explanation to you earlier was the requirements are more complicated in a public sector facility than if you're building a private sector facility. And I'm saying, even if you have a private developer build it, they've got to build it to the same state code that the fire marshal will approve. So I'm not sure you pick up anything. Does that make sense to everybody? How do we get too technical? Does that make sense? You can't avoid state law by building something contracting out private.
So I think there is a difference there, though, a little bit, because you're talking about the construction council there, not just building code type. You know, we all have to build by those.
Sure, sure.
But does the state hold them to higher standards in the construction phase as to what we're held to as builders if we go out and build it? I mean, I want to build a spec school, knowing I got a customer at the end and I sell it.
So what I do, let's answer you one. What I do know is this. Community college finance, community college can transfer the property to the county for the purposes of building a community college. The statute says, at the end of the day, the county's completed the project, they transfer the property back. This county's sometimes contracting. But the statute also says you can't avoid the requirements of GS-143 when it comes to construction.
Yes, sir. Yeah, state building code, Department of Insurance, tell everybody what they have to build to the standards.
That situation we decided, isn't that having something to do with taxes too, on materials?
It's a great question. On that part it does, because the county can get refunded in sales tax and the college put on. I do have a question that I want you to find, and that is this. In doing P3s with general obligation bonds, and I assume this is your bonds. Okay. In P3s, the IRS pays a lot of attention to private space occupancy of governmental space built with tax-exempt instruments. You know what I'm saying? If you're taking them, the bonds that are sold, Alamance County bonds, are tax-exempt bonds. Everybody with me on that? Okay. If you take tax-exempt money, build something that's occupied by a for-profit entity that runs smack in the face IRS rules on bonded indebtedness. It does. So you have to be careful if you are entering into a P3 arrangement where you're going to put up 50% of the money and your 50% is tax exempt. It may work unless the facility is going to be occupied or any portion thereof by for-profit entity. Then the IRS is going to say, you got arbitrage issues. You might keep that in mind as you're thinking for a P3 arrangement. You need to keep your money pure. Your tax exempt is going to build a facility for use by K-12, community colleges, or county. You're not gonna build it and then put a McDonald's franchise in. That ain't legal. That's an extreme case.
All the PPPs I've seen in the state of North Carolina that have been successful were in areas where they couldn't get money anywhere else.
Absolutely.
And or the government entity didn't want to go through the process and put it to the public or.
A bond.
Yeah, bond.
Or any kind of debt.
Or IE out of their fund balance.
Exactly right.
So, you know, and a square foot's a square foot. That has nothing to do with quality in that square foot. And in my opinion, you can go buy a charter school or another school that's been built with a PPP and then look at what the state would require to be in that same facility. And I guarantee you, quality is two different things, in my opinion. And go by 50 years from now, 40 years from now, see what it looks like. I'm sorry.
Well, will we even still be using school buildings in 50 years? That's a whole other issue.
Well, we better be.
And the charter school, Mr. Sutton, is going to have revenues to amortize the debt. K-12 only has revenues per big body count. I mean, to me, that's the distinction.
When you say 50%, if we just got $150 million, what a blessing. And if we did this with the new high school, would Bill and Tim and Amy and Steve have to give us half of the money that is estimated for that high school up front? Is that what you're saying to these people?
Up front? No.
Okay.
Because the
up front can mean a lot of things.
Because under state law, you can't prepay for services not rendered. You can't pay in advance for anything.
But it wouldn't be like, we've got the bond, and now we're going to take this money from Brian. That would be.
I would say the developer uses their money first, and then as you incur additional construction costs for real cost of construction, you get reimbursed for that.
That scares me.
You can't front any government. It's paid for. I'm looking at the CFO, the financial folks in the room. You can't get a discount for a bill by prepaying it. You've got to have an invoice for actual services and product delivery.
You're closer to Rod than we are. What?
That's a shame.
So I understand the state treasurer's office doesn't have a favorable opinion.
They do not. Neither does state construction.
Risk. What is a risk of that?
It's great. What if the developer goes belly up?
Ooh.
It happens.
It does. But you're going to build a spec school.
The risk factor definitely accelerates. Again, is this helpful? This is kind of, I applaud you. I wish more government would just sit down and talk about stuff like this. This would be great. But, all right, so selection options. Here we go. There's best qualified, and that's on qualifications alone. That would typically be architects or engineers, which is best qualified, best price, lump sum, low bid price alone. And then there's best value. Sealed competitive proposals, price, time, qualifications, and other factors. I think that's important to consider. All selections should be competitive in a governmental entity, and all should have the historically underutilized businesses. I talked about minority and women-owned. You've got to do it as a governmental entity. You've got to have that level of participation. So there's really best qualified, best price, and best value. So let's work through that. Best qualified, if you will, is very straightforward. It's based on the firm's qualifications, prices, and incentive. You look at factors. When Alamance Community College looked at a CM at risk, they interviewed firms. They had selection criteria. And looking at the firms, you're looking for what has this firm done? What have they built? What's the reputation? Check out their customers. Were they satisfied? Did they get lawsuits? Are they local? There's just myriad factors in the selection matrix. And you don't have to do it on the basis of price. You do it on okay. Best price, it's all around cost. Low first cost, low final cost. Only price matters. It's easy to evaluate. It's not a value-based selection, which is an important thing. Doesn't consider the hub commitment. That's not good. Some of the advantage, you get better pricing. You identify new contractors you've dealt with, not dealt with. Well, that's a double-edged sword. You don't know if you're dealing with a new contractor. It might be a good thing, it might be a bad thing. It avoids scope creep. It is, here's the price. Disadvantages, it's slow. Bonding adds costs. Tendency to get low price as well as low quality, to your point. If you go price alone, you get what you pay, honestly. And it's open to all properly licensed, properly insured contractors. Low price, low quality. Now, my favorite, best value. Competitive bids that compete on multiple factors. And in that, you're looking at a number of things. Price, time to completion, the firm's experience and capability, reputation, their HUD commitment, and there's, don't forget the safety record. It's on your property as you're being built. Don't forget the safety record, because you'll be enjoined in a suit if things go south. You will. You're the owner. So, best value makes sense to Kenan, and I think best value comes with things like construction manager at risk. Best practices or policies. This is going to be, I'm going into the subjective a little bit now with you. This is based on my experience. So what's a board to do? I think you use best qualified for professional services, engineers, designers. You use the best price for low cost, not big scope, low cost, time sensitive projects. I believe that best value is for all others. There's nothing magical about my benchmarks of single prime projects under 3.5. It's just based on experience. I have seen single prime done at large cost projects. I have. Increasingly, community colleges, universities, and public schools are using construction manager at risk for large, more complicated projects. Consider though, CMA for complex, I don't like that delivery model. I don't know that it's used very often. And design there, you should not close the door on design build, but I'm going to tell you kind of what I think and see might be possibilities for that. Best practices and evaluation criteria. A HUB subcontracting plan, look at costs and fees, but you don't have to do that for required professional services, firm experience and workload. Why not bring firms in an interview? I think you should interview firms, not one but many. You can start with a scope of 10, have a committee that looks at proposals, bring 3 or 4 in, have a conversation with them, meet them face to face, do some background work on them, some homework, figure out if they're reputable. And there are a number of those in the state. Check the state construction office, they'll tell you. They'll tell you if they've had problems with problems before. Get that commitment on the HUB contract. Have they been sued and for what reasons? Sometimes owners are sued happy, but check out their background, their legal background. These are best practices in evaluating. Lessons learned, some of the lessons learned out there. Best value requires upfront preparation. You need to know your scope. You need to know, like, you're building a new high school or you're renovating an existing high school. You're going to build a biotechnology. You know what you're going to do. It's not, you don't have to come up with the idea. You already got a facilities plan, for goodness sake. In your selection process, make sure you define your criteria, put a team together, evaluate that, go through the process and come up with a firm that you think is best suited. Patience. In any capital project, you're going to have setbacks. You're going to find things you didn't know about. You're going to, especially if you're renovating. So you start tearing things out, you just don't truly know. My wife and I used to have a joke. When we were first married, we lived in an old house. They had renovated the old house. You know what we had? An old house. And so I asked my wife after 3 years, "Dear, that's a beautiful old house. What is it?" She said, "It's an old house. It might look new, but it's an old house." So just keep that in mind. You're going to find things. Shared savings make little difference, but if you're going to talk about them in a CM, put them in the contract. Put them in the contract. People say, "Guys, take it so long to get this design plan." Best time you ever spend is on the upfront design. Best time you ever spent. And someone's always going to tell you, Ms. Thompson, I can build a chicken.
For $5 million.
At least $5 million. No matter what you're building, well, my price is like $2 million. We can build a $5 million chicken. All right. Some of my issues to be aware of. This is Kenan's off-list record here. To keep in mind, you probably need, I would say, all three of these need a hunter's rep. I think Alamance needs one. NDSS has one. I think the county might want to think about it. It's not a bad idea. You're spending $190 million for this, so why not have that person who can talk the language and reveal to you as your representative? Traffic flow, you think that's, you may think that's, that doesn't make sense, but ACC's going to bump into it. We did at Asheville. Anytime you build something, it's going to be disrupted. So think about your traffic. It's a simple thing, but it can annoy the heck out of you. So keep, especially faculty and parents. So just keep that. Swing space during renovations. You may have to move people out. Where are you going to put them? Always think about swing space. Staging. Remember, you got to have a site, you got to put stuff. They're going to drop off steel for the footings. They're going to drop off pipes. They're going to drop off conduit. They're going to drop off whatever. You got to have staging spaces. They're going to be surprises. The thing is, you want to plan so carefully in the front end, you don't get big cost surprises on the back end. And I know that your plan is just smart. You all are setting aside some contingency funds going forward for those unexpected little angle blinders that come up. In my view, you're in a tough market. You're in a tough market. Yeah. I'm seeing the CFO back there nodding. Price escalation is killing everything. Just know it's going to happen. That's why contingencies are critical. That's why I've seen the rich get a guaranteed maximum price, and you're going to hold them to it. The cost of energy and sustainable design, whatever you're doing, keep that in mind. Renovations mean opportunities to lower your heating and cooling costs. Electricity and wind shield, energy, keep that in mind. All right, so this is Kenan's staff just taking the county projects, putting them in boxes. A construction manager risk for your human services building, maybe. Your deferred maintenance, maybe. New high school, the center of excellence, the parking deck, and the judiciary campus. I would think about those methods of delivery in all of those projects. And I looked out, I'm here to 21-22. I think the CMIT risk makes sense for these projects. I've taken a look at the public schools projects, but I really focused on the campus projects first. All right? Now you're gonna see some redundancy, because you have to decide with your human services building and deferred maintenance, does it make more sense on the small project scope to go single prime? That's something you kick around. And if you had an owner's rep at the county level, they could help you make those decisions, in my opinion. So you could do them either way. I would say on the conversion of the elderly services building to mental health conversion center, that's clearly a single prime. There's no doubt about that to me. The Southern High School renovation might be an opportunity for a single prime. Are you shaking his head no?
We're doing the CMR.
See all that.
We have a large swing space, a large building, and demolition. So to have more control over the safety of the campus.
That's a good
reason.
To have
more control over cost, because our renovations involved in that particular project, we chose CMR at risk. Just because of those critical areas.
And again, public school projects are very unique, especially the tear outs and build backs. You may discover some things you, oh my gosh. I mean, you get an OMG on it.
Let someone else discover that up front.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what I look at.
County facility projects, the miscellaneous group, single prime. When I looked at those projects individually and I thought about them, I think single prime makes sense. And even the, you're adding a cell block in the county jail, I think that's a single prime. they make sense to me to fit into those policies. The downtown grant parking deck, I think that's a really good design deal. I really think parking deck is a parking deck, it's a parking deck. And it's a Piedmont, they put brick facades on them. They're beautiful, they look like the campus. The envelope is the same, but okay, it's a parking deck. So I think that makes sense when you get to that place. I think for Alamance, parking deck. I really do. I think it's designed it. You're not talking about highly technical, complicated problems. You will have some lighting, you have some electrical system stuff in there, and plumbing drainage, but
they're not like community college. We put those two together, and there's some design possibilities that you can build the park station by the tech center.
Very good.
It always sad and it out there.
Yeah. Okay, one project.
Smart.
Yes, sir.
I love to tell this one. I may never tell it again. I don't plan on being around all the time. We built this jail across the street. The new park. And they put out bids or whatever. And my point is to try and be innovative with who you seek to put in a bid. Somehow. Not just sit and wait for them to reply. Or seek out.
Sure.
So we had a guy drive up here, one from South Carolina, Jaguar, hair down to the shoulders. Goodness, that sounds stereotypical, but I was skeptical from the start. And Bill, you were on the board.
I was thinking all those horror stories you're getting ready to hear.
Well, no, this is just what you
might say some bad times for that contractor. We fired him because he's incompetent.
Anyway, what it was, I think we initially, the bid was $12 million, all right? So I wasn't satisfied that he was the right one and that we'd done our homework. So I called the County Commissioner Association, which I very seldom do. And I got him on the phone and I said, don't you guys have a list of people that build jails in that southeast? North Carolina, the southeast. Well, yeah. And they went to a list. I was on the phone 2 minutes.
You seen the list?
Came back and read me the list of contractors, architects, whatever. I called the first one, Hemphill and Associates, Charlotte, North Carolina. He didn't put in a bid. And are you familiar with them?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you may know some horror stories, but I'm going to tell you what they told me. He said, well, I didn't know about what you were doing. I didn't see it. And he said, we would love to put in a bid on it, or whatever. And I said, tell me a little bit about your company. He said, well, it's over 100 years old, roughly. He said, great day to start. And I said, well, what are your qualifications? He said, well, we really, and it's just laid back. He said, well, we don't really do a whole lot of promoting on it, at least that's what he told me. He said, but if it means anything to you, he said, we were the lead architect for Strong Thurmond Federal Courthouse in Columbia, South Carolina.
Uh-oh.
And I said, well, it's not like you got some qualifications. So he came up to our jail. The county manager had, and I won't mention the name, and it wasn't Brian Haygood. He was across, when he come over to me. So I got to come up with a presentation, and in all honesty, he said, what have you done? He just got through with Davidson County, where he built an addition to the jail, a garage, huge open corridor and three courtrooms for $10 million, and maybe pushing 11. I said, well, can you factor out, this is a conversation, can you factor out courtrooms, corridor, and parking lot? Then what you can do basically with the jail, which I think bid is about the same. And got well, $4 or $5 million, and it's laid back. And he came up and gave a presentation, and it went nowhere. It went nowhere with the commission. But Bill and I opposed the $12 million deal until we got factored in INS, will incorporate with us, and whatever. But that was just out of a phone call. And I think that you may know something bad about him, but I don't. And, you know, we could have built that jail for probably six men at the very minimum.
Absolutely correct.
With a qualified contractor or architect that we didn't know about because, well, he didn't put in his whatever. He's on the list, all you gotta do is find it. And talk to him, look at. And I don't think we're that innovative with finding people that do quality, get more efficient maybe with pricing. On both ends, whether it's school or us, check it out.
So I would, for those off list, I would call them off list people, I would encourage them to submit a bid.
Sure.
Absolutely, yeah. Encourage them. I think there's nothing wrong with soliciting.
Save a lot of money.
But I think you still need to go through an established process at the risk of something going wrong. Because you're gonna need someone to stand behind you if something goes wrong.
Sure.
And there's so much work in the marketplace right now. So much work. You're gonna have price escalation, cost escalation. You're also gonna have contractors who are not as experienced doing work, and it raises your risk. Does that make sense? I think you want to deal with reputable folks who have good track records. So they can just bid through the process, and if there truly are lower costs, that'll show up. So that would be my advice.
Ken, I was just thinking for us, we sent an RFP or RFQ minimal services for the report. Not only do we advertise by the local statute, we also are contacting other districts and other folks and saying, okay, give us an email this to people. And we'll send it out to as many people as we can because we're like you, searching for the best quality, the best price. And that's because you can advertise locally one time and you know, five or six people might pick it up. But like our architects, we had 26 months. And we interviewed all 26 of them, which was a challenge within itself, but you know, we spent time with folks. So yeah, I'm just sort of piggybacking on what you're saying. It's a good idea to put it out there as far as you can.
More competition to that.
Yeah, the little stuff as much as we can use a lot of people. Or the best quality.
And single prime is good.
Yeah, because we got a lot of talent.
They got a lab weapon also.
Absolutely. We know what
they do. Single prime works good. Big projects, I would say CO. Other questions or comments?
On the design part of it, price is not, that's not variable for people picking those to do that.
That's a good answer for us.
And the state construction office makes the decision.
I think for relationships, Mr. Brogdon, come in. For example, the ACCT, I called colleagues in state construction. I said, listen, the board's gone through. We got 10 proposals. They interviewed 3 firms. This is who they really want. He said, well, we've had experience with them. We're good. We want to get a shade of price for you. It's reasonable. You're now going to have any cost. Your availability. And it worked out beautiful. And that's where that relationship portion of the state construction.
So for him, state construction company negotiates that rate. The public schools will negotiate that rate. So what we have to do is reach out to our construction office as well as reach out to other folks around us and say, okay, what percent is sort of market buying? And that's where we establish what we think we should cost. Because if we go to, let's say, I interview as an architect and you say you want $50 million to go to school, I thought Steve he wants $150 million. Well, I can't come back again unless I put RFQ back out again, cancel it, go back out again. Then your price might be $125 million. So it's done strictly on best.
That's how it's choose the firm.
Right. You know, best, what we feel is best. Reputation plays a big part in that. The advantage we have in so many architectural firms is we have to meet people face to face because if you take these books, the proposals they send in, they all look the same. They all are answering exactly what you ask. But we spend the time sort of getting other people to fill the people. And yeah, that leads a whole lot if you can work with them.
Exactly what ACC is. That's what we started 9 years ago.
I think they had 30 submittals on the original one. They narrowed down to 6.
Interview the 6?
Six is still a large number. It's very good. A lot of people do.
1 or 2 like that.
That's exactly what I wrote. So it's time consuming. But again, all that upfront work is so important to back side. Really true. So, Madam Chairs, I have, thanks to Andrea, I have the PowerPoint and a little leave behind document that explains all of these according to statute. I'm glad to take any more questions or comments along the way, but I sincerely appreciate the opportunity. I hope this added value and was helpful today, just going through the conversation. Ms. Thompson wants to find $5 million.
Thank you so much. And I also want to say thank you to all the elected officials who took, you know, we're all really busy, and I very much appreciate that, you know, we have people who are engaged and trying to learn about. It's really complicated with our staff and through. So thank you so much, and I hope everything goes well for you the rest of the week.